Despite ultimately winning the Second Boer War, the British felt they were at a disadvantage fielding the magazine Lee Enfield against the Boers' Mausers. They would research a new high-velocity cartridge and heavy-barreled rifle, but the First World War would intervene and send their plans in an unexpected direction. Hi, I'm Othais, and this... Oh, nobody actually cares about this gun. This is the Enfield Pattern 14 rifle. Let's get it over to the light box. With an overall length of 46 1/4 inches, this is not the longest rifle we've seen so far, but it weighs in at an impressive 9.4 pounds. It chambers the 303 cartridge, feeding 5 from a stripper clip into its integral box magazine. Right at the turn of the century, the British would form the Small Arms Committee. I think that name speaks for itself, but just so you know, they were researching rifles, handguns, machine guns, basically anything that we'd like to cover on this show. I hope they're fans. Their job was to scour the world for innovation, reviewing adoptions by other countries and new designs from commercial concerns. They would also assess the needs of the Empire as times changed. From there, they would recommend modifications to existing weapons or the adoption of whole new systems. Turning back to the Second Boer War, the British experienced many of the same issues that the US did during the Spanish-American War. Namely, they ran into the Mauser 1893 system, often dated 1895 or 6 as purchased by the Boers. This rugged, rapid-fire, rapid-loading, long-range, flat-shooting 7mm cartridge gun was perfect for the African veldt. In this open terrain, the Boers really dominated in terms of rifle fire and marksmanry. Now, the British would win in the end with other tactics, but the long Lees were barely keeping up despite being, 50% heavier and a lot longer. And the carbines that were arming the cavalry, who were necessary for getting around in this terrain, they weren't faring very well either. Now, part of that upset about maneuverability versus range versus carbine, all that's going to get rolled into another rifle that we'll talk about in the future, known as the short magazine Lee Enfield. I'm sure nobody gives a rat's about that gun. Anyway, back to a real gun. The British... they mulled this over quite a bit. They started playing with cartridges, but the real movement happened much later in 1910 when the director of artillery would write something resembling a memo over the Small Arms Committee. "Will you please consider the question of a suitable mechanism for a new rifle? No recommendation is required from the committee at present, but supposing the Army Council decides to introduce a new magazine rifle, it is desirable that these questions should have been previously considered." This simple request would get the gears moving, and it would involve some pretty big names. At that time, the Small Arms Committee featured members like the Commandant of the School of Musketry at Hythe, you've got the Chief Small Arms Inspector, the Chief Inspector over at Woolwich, you've got representatives from the Navy, the Cavalry, the Infantry, the Territorial Forces. There's a lot of people of real good credentials that are piled up on this issue, and honestly, it seems like they were waiting for a chance to voice their opinions, because... before the end of that year, September even, they had a list ready to go of exactly what sort of things they wanted to see in a new infantry rifle. Mind you, this is no design. These are just sort of like, we want these sorts of things lined up. Now, at the time, the main rifle is the short magazine Lee Enfield, like we said, the Smellie. Now, a lot of this list can be seen as both praise and criticism of the current rifle. And because we have future vision, we can go ahead and talk about the P14 that's about to come out of all this mess. So let's go ahead and run down that list and do a comparison of whether these features were found in the current rifle or in this one to come. The new gun should be universal, common to infantry and cavalry. The length and weight should be as near as possible to the present Smellie. It should have a one-piece stock. It should have a trapped butt plate like the Smellie. The current nose cap and sight protector with that method of bayonet attachment, that should be retained. It should have a full-length handguard. They would prefer a heavier barrel, one seated right near 2 pounds 14 ounces. That's where they saw the best results in their previous testing. The recoil should remain similar to the current Smelly. It should have a detachable 10-round magazine. There should be no provision for a magazine cutoff. It should be charger loading. They would prefer a Mauser-type action with symmetrical front locking lugs, a separate bolt head, a rotary bolt, like on the Smelly, honestly, a rimless cartridge, a trigger attached to the receiver, not to the trigger guard, a safety catch to lock in both positions of the cocking piece, a striker controlled by the cocking piece. It should also have a receiver-mounted rear aperture sight with fold-down battle sight. It should be cock on open, and the bolt handle should be as near as possible to the trigger when placed forward. When the British went looking for their new rifle, while unlike the US, they did not go straight to the Mauser. Instead, they were inspired by a series of three rifles that ultimately led to the final design. The first is rather unusual. It's the Godsell rifle. This wacky-looking thing was one of a famous pair considered to replace the underperforming Lee Enfield carbines. This and the Thorncraft represented early bullpup concepts, with the magazine behind the trigger in an attempt to keep a full-length barrel on a short rifle. It also chambered, and this is important, a high-velocity, flat-shooting cartridge somewhere around 7mm. Now, features of the Godsell rifle would go on to be incorporated into our second rifle, the Norman. This gun was put forward by BSA and featured a front-locking bolt with the same inclined plane as the Godsell, meant to allow the shooter to maintain his line of sight. Again, it was chambered for a high-velocity cartridge, this time in .276. At a glance, we can see that our Pattern 14 will take a lot of its profile from the Norman. But what about those Mauser action requests? What donor rifle could bring home the Mauser without being an actual Mauser? This is the US Springfield Model 1903 rifle. For those of you unfamiliar with it, the 1903 is a Mauser-derived cock-on-open rifle adopted by the good old US of A. We'll probably talk about it later, maybe, I guess. The Brits modified it with an aperture sight mounted to the rear of the receiver. Man, when are we ever going to see that again? Oh, also, they totally stretch Armstrong that bolt handle. From these three sources, we're going to see the Royal Small Arms Factory at Enfield assemble a prototype rifle in 1911. Well, C is a special word because, unfortunately, I found no images of this thing. It was apparently put together by the manager, Francis Carnegie, and the chief designer, Ernest Revel. I keep wanting to say reveal, I think it's Revel, although I'm sure everyone will complain that I mispronounced it anyway. Alright, anyway, these guys got together and combined the best features into one gun. Like I said, no images of this thing, and I even went so far as to pester poor Jonathan Ferguson, who is the curator of firearms over at the Royal Armouries, and has provided us with tons of interesting images that I've worked our line drawings out of, but this guy is elusive. But we do have notes, criticisms of the gun, and from that, I think we can work up a rough picture. Working from the list, they were told to ditch that smelly style nose cap for a normal rifle one. So I guess it had a smelly nose cap. They wanted to add a two-position battle sight instead of just one-position aperture, so I guess it had that. The stock was too thick and should be stepped in front of the magazine instead of sloped. The wrist should be modified to emulate the smelly pattern. They were asked to shorten the cocking piece, so I guess it had a long one, and move the bolt handle further rearward and poke it out a bit more. As for the magazine, we have no idea if this was a 5-rounder, 10-rounder, or had no magazine at all. Further notes that really don't add to this picture include, to try out a bead front sight, the ejection was too strong, complaints about the rear sight in general with markings and things. Was the cocking knob even necessary? Can the follower be made to interrupt the bolt when empty? And is a separate bolt head really necessary? A lot of those would get implemented in the next design. By the way, while we're talking about this rifle development, I need to say that there's cartridge development going on the whole time in parallel, and I'm just not that strong on cartridge development, and honestly a lot of those little notes get lost. So, all you really need to know is that they experimented with both 0.256 of an inch and 2.76 of an inch cartridges. The 2.56 was not quite as accurate, so it was dropped. The 2.76 continually ran into the same repeated problems with overheating and extraction. They would basically fiddle with the design of the case and the bullet and the shoulder and the angles and the slope. It would just get reworked and reworked and reworked repeatedly until we settle into what is now known as 2.76 Enfield. This powerful round featured a rimless case and was wholly more modern than the existing 303 cartridge. Its high velocity made it a flat shooter, increasing point-blank range and easing long-range fire. Unfortunately, all this power would plague any rifle chambering it, with excessive barrel wear, rapid overheating, a risk of cooking off a round when chambered, and heavy recoil and muzzle blast. By the end of 1911, another set of prototype rifles was ready, and then shortly after that, early 1912, we've got two more ready. Most of the reason why there's four of these things is just to experiment through the cartridges like we mentioned. All four of them share roughly the same features though. They had aperture rear sights fixed over the chamber area, and they had a fold down battle sight as requested. They were styled for a 5-round magazine, but no actual magazine was fitted yet. The debate raged on. Complaints included that the stock was difficult to hold, so checkering was tried on a few. Rear sight range markings were hard to read. Ejection was still a problem. Bolt travel was too long. The trigger guard was too small. And the safety was too easy to knock loose. This series would cause a flurry of patents for a new foresight protector, bolt, bolt stop, and improved safety. By the way, these patents, they were mostly registered under the name of Francis Carnegie, and apparently the government wanted this to happen because it gave some level of extra control over these features in case they were adopted by other militaries or tried to be marketed commercially. Basically, it was CYA. So that was encouraged, it was planned, and that's why you see Carnegie's name all over everything, even though a lot of this was done with him and Revel. Now, in addition, around the time that these prototypes wrapped up, they finally solidified on the idea of a 5-shot integral magazine. Now, a lot of you may be concerned as to why you would want to go from the 10-round magazine of the Lee Enfield to a 5-round magazine, but there are some advantages. Number one, with the oversized cartridge, they were running into feed problems. Now, some of this would be in the bolt too, as we'll later find out. But if you have a shorter magazine, you have more even spring pressure, it's easier to tune to the cartridge. Number two, if you have a big unwieldy cartridge and you're feeding from a stripper clip, it's easy to feed 5 into the magazine real quick and go than to having to double stripper clip feed every time to get 10 into the magazine and deal with them sort of orienting in that mag. Additionally, the way the Lee Enfield magazine works honestly was a bit of a bother for some officials because it was a very common point to damage and to be sent in for repair. Because it stuck out like that and it was made out of such cheap metal, it broke. I mean, it didn't break often enough. We still like the smelly, but let's be honest, it is a weak point in the gun compared to other points in the gun. So they thought, hey, 5 rounds, we're nice and flush, we're not going to get all these repair requests, and do we really need to be loading 10 at a time anyway? Obviously, opinions will change about that later on in history. With that decision made, by the end of 1912, things were sort of wrapping up. 1,000 rifles were ordered for extensive trials. These would be produced into early 1913, with the trials happening shortly after in that year, so they were named the Pattern 13. In the end, that number would be bumped up to roughly 1,200. These would be issued to the Northern and Southern Commands. They would go to Ireland, Egypt, South Africa, and be issued to 2 schools of musketry. They were extensively tested and generally well received, except for a few minor complaints. Most of those would be resolved in an improved model. This is what it addressed. It addressed the weird finger grooves that nobody really liked. It addressed the fact that when they milled out the back of the receiver, they left it kind of sharp. So when you were doing bayonet drills, you could really hurt your hand. Another thing is that they experimented with the idea of maybe doing a half handguard to save on the wood and trying to get that fine fitting. This was sort of dropped when they realized that after only 10 rounds fired, there was no way you could fix bayonets on that barrel. It was cooking. Anyway, like I said, these get wrapped up into one final model. Six are produced just to sort of try out. And then, like so many other things that we've seen with our development histories in World War I, war were declared. Wisely, the British decided there was no way that they were going to field two rifle cartridges. And so they were going to stick with good old 303. This cartridge, now on Mark 7, was really a standard of the Empire. We're not going to get into too much detail about it. I just wanted you to see the ballistics. We'll cover this more when we get over to the Lee Enfield rifles. British volunteer forces would be rapidly expanded by the institution of a draft and the war itself. You're going to go from a small expeditionary force of 250,000 max to 2 million by 1915. This is huge, and you can't forget that getting men is only half the problem. You also have to get equipment, and rifles especially take time to assemble. So they needed to make more guns now, or else they were going to outstrip their total possible supply and production. So they started looking around for more manufacturers to produce rifles, and when they did, they realized that that pattern 13 that they had been working on, well, it was a lot simpler to produce than the short magazine Lee Enfield, and so it could be offered to shops that couldn't necessarily meet the technical requirements for the Lee Enfield. Now, that means that it has fewer machining operations, it's simpler to construct, it has fewer assemblers, it's generally more efficient to produce in a war of attrition. And so they would do a cursory, and this is important because it is not a detailed redesign, in October of 1914 to sort of prove that the gun could work in 303, and then they would take those plans and send them out for contract. Their first choice was BSA, and they approached them repeatedly to be declined every time. Perhaps that's because BSA saw the problems that were about to plague all of the producers through the war. Instead, Vickers Limited would step up to the plate, and in June of 1915, they signed a contract for 100,000 rifles. Unfortunately, this never was realized. Only a handful of prototypes were ever sent in, and they were constantly rejected. Twofold problem on this one for Vickers. One was the heavy competition for men and skilled machinists, and two, there were a lot of mitigating factors in the U.S. at the time. Competition for raw materials and machinery, and some various strikes going on in the U.S. made it very hard for them to get tooled up. So the whole thing was canceled in July of 1916, although they did produce some bayonets. Meanwhile, rifle shortages were actually beginning to slow training of new recruits, and more obsolete long lees were making it to the front out of sheer necessity. So great was demand that Japanese Arisaka, Winchester lever actions, Canadian Ross rifles, and Remington rolling blocks were being purchased to free up any and all standard short magazine Lee Enfields or even long Lees as possible. Britain still needed a new and large supply of frontline ready rifles. The War Office would contract with Winchester Repeating Arms, Remington UMC, and Remington of Eddystone. And those initial contracts were for 400,000 from Winchester, 1 million from Remington, and 2 million from Eddystone. Now, the first contract of 200,000 coming out of Winchester would be sold for $32.50 a pop. After that, the next 200,000 would be negotiated for $30, and that's what all the other manufacturers were paid for their rifles. So Winchester got, what, 200,000 times 250 extra off of anybody else? That's not too bad. Let's stop here though, because we have a gun, it's being produced, and we can take an actual look at it. So let's zoom in and take a look at what makes the P14 the P14. Alright, there we are, take a quick glance, and already it should be fairly obvious that we're working with a Mauser action. We've got our full length extractor, and our front locking lugs. We did not opt for a separate bolt face, obviously. We have a nice thick receiver. You guys can't tell at home, but this is an incredibly heavy, stout barrel, even though it was reamed out for 303 from that 276. Again, we are feeding the rimmed 303 cartridge. That means that it's a bit of a bother to get this magazine dialed in. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but it works now that it's done. We also featured no grabbable cocking piece. Instead, it's just sort of shrouded in there. It's cock on close rather than on open. It's a very smooth action. For sighting, we do have our rear aperture sight placed just about 4 inches from the eye. It's beautiful to look through, honestly. We have the battle sight we wanted. This is critically important because let's say that you are fighting, and let me get this where you guys can see it. Let's say you're fighting with the... There we go. You're fighting with our long sight here. You have it dialed in exactly where you want it to be for range, and then something unexpected happens, cavalry pops up, a dude sneaks up on you, whatever. You don't want to have to grab, pinch, shove, click, whatever. You don't want to have to fiddle with fine motor control. You want to slap and then have it line back up for your short-range battle sight, which is right here. It's a beautiful system. Also included on this gun is a thumb safety set right at the bolt handle so that you don't have to interrupt your grip in order to flick the safety on and off. So if we are safe and we are lined up on the sights, we can just thumb up and over and we're ready to go. We do not have to disturb our grip. Also considering the grip, they put in this dog leg bolt, as people like to call it. It deposits your hand on operation as close to the trigger as possible, as organically as possible. My palm, you know, that top of your palm where you're working the bolt, once we drop, look at my finger, it goes back like an inch and boom, I'm on the trigger. It's a beautiful rapid fire system. Honestly, quite brilliant. Let's turn this guy around. Whoa. As I whack everything in sight. The British, specifically on the P14, and these are uncommon as we'll talk about later, they fitted a volley sight, which is just a simple flip up, but boy, you gotta kind of crank on it, and I don't have fingernails. There we go. Once that's flipped up, you peep through there and eyeball this guy who's dialed in with his little markers for further ranges. This is supposed to replace light artillery in a way. You're supposed to be able to lay sort of a pattern of fire over the horizon on enemy positions and disrupt, you know, activity. It's not really supposed to be all that lethal. It's supposed to be more of a bother. Volley sights would fall out of favor. It's actually interesting that right as these rifles were finally being produced in the US, the volley sights were being removed from the short magazine Lee Enfields at home. We'll talk about that in another video. All right, otherwise, not a lot to point out except for the heavily reinforced front sight protector. They really wanted this guy to be safe. And the heavily reinforced and very iconic rear sight protector that is contoured right along with that battle sight, which is where you get that interesting, you know, swooped profile. Honestly, it looks a lot like a 57 Chevy to me. Okay, well, with that all wrapped up and looked at, let's get it over to, honestly, an animation. We're gonna get a nice look inside this thing with our X-ray vision and just let you see what we've been talking about this whole time. Since we've already covered the Mauser, there's not a lot here. I mean, you're seeing a familiar two-stage trigger assembly. They did mount it to the receiver, unlike the Enfield. That's great. We do now have a cock-on close bolt body, but that's also been on previous Mauser designs. The only really unique thing here is going to be that safety, which interrupts the cocking piece and prevents fire. Otherwise, relax and enjoy the show. All right, let's let Mae do her thing now.
We'll load 5 rounds from a stripper clip. Aim this heavy thing and squeeze. The safety is easily operated with the right hand. And looking at the target, no bad. Back to Othais.
To many of you at home, that probably looked like fun. But this is history. It is super serious business, and Mae enjoys none of it. Alright, back to the story of this gun. They started production in early of 1916, but those were mostly sort of prototype and trials models that were sent off to inspection. I shouldn't say trials. It's not like trials as if they're being fielded by anybody. It's trials as in, will the British inspectors accept this or not? They're being some awful bastards about this. Why are they so dang picky? Didn't they want these guns anyway? Anyway, what starts to happen is they run into serious problems because his initial plans to convert this gun over to 303, they weren't really complete and it didn't work perfectly. There were a lot of problems and minor adjustments to be made. And not only that, but because they were working from, you know, a 1,000-lot sample of P-13s, the example rifles that were sent over, they were most likely those 6 improved models. Not all 3 of them matched. So, all 3 manufacturers had different guns. And that means there were slight differences in each model. So, interchangeability between them was lost. And at first, the British inspectors were furious with this. And they tried to crack down on it. But after months went by, and there was still little to no traction, and they were still, you know, red stamping everything, all 3 manufacturers threatened to pull. They wanted to walk. They were losing money because none of these were accepted. They weren't getting paid. They demanded that the British simplify these errors, and so they would ultimately relent on the interchangeability issue. And we end up with, despite there being one Pattern 14 at that time, we have 3 submodels right away. That means we have the Pattern 14 Mark 1 W for Winchester, the Pattern 14 Mark 1 R for Remington, and the Pattern 14 Mark 1 E for Eddystone. That would free up production beginning in June of 1916 in real earnest, but problems still continued to mount, and there were still a lot of rumblings from the manufacturers, so much so that the British would send out 2 men specifically to renegotiate and sort out this mess. It was becoming troublesome. So these 2 guys show up and they make a lot of recommendations and changes. They start watching the finances more carefully, yada, yada, yada. The 2 things that we care about from these men, though, are that 1, the British government agrees to purchase basically the overhead material. So you're talking about the special machines bought to manufacture these, the extra parts, the tools, raw materials, things like that. It all is purchased outright by the British government and now belongs to the British government. Essentially, they own the assembly lines inside the factories. And 2, the numbers of rifles that were contracted for were reduced. Winchester would be knocked down to 235,293 rifles, that is really specific. Remington would be knocked down to a much easier 400,000, and Eddystone would be marked down to a 1,176,471 number. Again, this is weirdly specific. This would later get rounded down to a much more even 600,000. With that, we keep on rolling until December of 1916, in which time we have now stocked up roughly 300,000 of these puppies, and the British inspectors are still having some minor problems. Samples from this lot revealed that they were having some problems with feeding and extraction. The extraction portion, they couldn't find a consistent thread to pull on to fix that issue. Honestly, to me, it sounds like we're dealing with that service ammunition problem that also plagued the Ross, in addition to actual problems with the Ross. Once you sort of have proper 303 in these guns, it doesn't seem like there's any complaints. Chalk it up to ammo. But as far as actually feeding the guns, well, the ammo is roughly in spec and it should feed relatively well. So the British would make a small change to try to aid in feeding. I'm not even sure of the geometry on this, but what they did is they extended the front lugs forward just a tiny bit and put in a matching recess into the barrel. This becomes the Pattern 14 Mark 1 Star, or first revision. These will be marked both on the bolt handle and the stock with the star. Finally, in January of 1917, 100 of these little puppies would be sent to the front to see just how they did. And apparently the British weren't that impressed. The aperture was well received, the heavy barrel was well received in terms of accuracy and precision shooting. The rest, Not as well loved. Troops really liked having 10 rounds. They thought that the repeated loading of the 5-rounder just introduced more mud into the system. Being a Mauser 98 action, you can get mud up into that extractor. Being front-locking, mud can pile up into the receiver, whereas, weirdly enough, a rear-locking design can be kept a little cleaner of mud, like the Lee Enfield, because there's less travel to get it out of the action. In other words, this big, heavy, clumsy gun was not impressing anybody, and so the British, who now had caught up with short magazine Lee Enfield production, who now had a more stable front, who had now sort of settled their business, they decided to relegate this to second line duty and training. In other words, the P-14 was meant to displace short magazine Lee Enfields wherever possible so that they could be moved up to the front. And that's about it. So, realistically for the British, this was not much of a war rifle. Production would wrap up in the middle of 1917 because of this, and that worked out pretty well because the US was now entering the war, and they could use a new rifle. With roughly 1.2 million produced by the end of things, its presence in the war was significant, even though it was limited in action. But it did not stay completely off the front line. Because of German trench shields, the Pattern 13 was considered for modification to an armor-piercing role. At that time, the British and French were using commercial hunting rifles with special large-bore ammunition. The strong Pattern 13 action would be perfect for adaptation to a new round, possibly 470. At least one armor-piercing P-13 was tried out in the trenches, but it proved inferior to the present commercial solutions. And they thought about doing a 276 armor-piercing cartridge, but by then 303 armor-piercing was developed, and that was doing well enough without having to introduce new supply problems. But that's not the end of this rifle's attempt to be on the front, because the precision, like we said, was notable, and so Winchester models specifically, because there was some perception that Winchesters were better, they were fitted with a new finely adjustable sight, just like the one here, but with a little dial on it. That sight made the gun into the Mark 1 W parentheses F, or Mark 1 star W parentheses F. These were used in non-telescoped sniper roles. Thanks to these guns, shortly after a telescopic sight would be fitted, this would become the Mark 1 star, only the stars were done, W parentheses T. These guns really didn't see any use on the battlefield before the end of the war, though, so they had no effect, realistically. But, they stuck around through the interwar period and were further modified with different, you know, scopes and things like that. And so, you'll have telescoped P-14s at the beginning of World War II. Post-war, plenty of standard P-14s would be greased up and put into storage. As the political situation evolved around the world, a lot of these would be given away to allies, especially in Latvia and Lithuania, where they were given away pretty freely as a check against Russian aggression in the region. At the outbreak of World War II, plenty of these guys were still on hand, and so they would be updated in what was known as the Whedon Repair Standard. The biggest point on this, other than just general inspection, was the removal, almost universally, of the volley sights, which means that any of these retained by Britain, I mean, we're talking about near 100%, they had their volley sights removed. And so the most common P-14s you'll find out there are ones without volley sights. These are World War II updates. So you kind of got to hope for a re-imported one if you want to get these volleys. All right, so the Whedon Repair Standard would also, in cases of split or worn stocks, go ahead and issue a new stock. It looks just like the stock on a 1917, so there's no groove or fitting for the volley sights at all. These would be issued primarily to the Home Guard, although some did find their way into things like, you know, allies like Free Polish Forces and forces in the Middle East, things like that. All right, wrapping things up for the P-14, we should probably mention that, don't forget, the British told Carnegie and they told those two gentlemen to go ahead and patent everything. Well, they were also told to go ahead and seek compensation for their final design. They were awarded, combined, not individually, £450. What a fortune. All right, let's go ahead and get this gun over to Mae and get her opinion on firing the P-14. For anyone curious why we haven't talked about the 1917 yet, that is our next episode. That's when I said, are you sure it's supposed to smell like that? Anyway, we've made room for Mae, so let's go ahead and get her opinion on this British classic, the P14. Here.
Thank you.
Can we start off with ergonomics?
Yes, I believe we can get right into the ergonomics of this. So, first off the bat, picking up this gun, instantly noticed it's got a good bit of weight to it. However, it's fairly well balanced. It's all right. It is a little bit muzzle heavy, but you know, it's not that big of a deal. The next thing I want to talk about are two things about the stock that I noticed. I have heard online people complaining about how this fat belly right here, just they kind of feel like they have to stretch their hand almost to grip it comfortably. However, for me, yeah, see, I grip it a little more forward, so it feels like that fat belly is actually creating a sort of perch for me to pull against. So I feel like I'm kind of just pulling it into my shoulder almost. The second thing I do want to talk about is this thin wrist. Now, they did take that from the smelly, I understand that. I actually love this thin wrist semi-pistol grip. This is fantastic. My hand just feels like I'm able to get a good solid grip on it. I don't feel like I'm going to lose it. And even better, this hawkbill swoop right here that I'm able to rest my pinky against. It feels like I'm able to just pull this right nicely into my shoulder with both the fat belly and this hawkbill right here. I don't feel like I'm going to slip my grip at all. But as far as ergonomics go, this was actually a really pleasant gun.
So what I'm hearing, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that overall you love the rear end of the gun, and maybe a little shorter or a little less muzzle heavy, and you'd be a lot happier with it.
Yeah, pretty much. It has the potential to be even better, but honestly, I still enjoyed it.
We're doing well so far, so let's go ahead to the next stage. What do you think about actually firing this gun?
So first off, I actually want to talk about these sights, because I love them. They're to the back of the receiver, so my sight radius is excellent. And it's an aperture sight, which is amazing. And not only that, these are actually raised up off the gun slightly. So if anything, I felt like this expanded my field of vision, so that if an enemy was down low and popped up at any moment, I felt like I just had a better reaction time as a result of that. There wasn't any of the wood of the gun getting in my way of the sight. It was fantastic. Next I want to talk about is actually the bolt itself. I thought, you know, cock and close, it was going to be a little harder to manipulate, but I didn't find it that bad. Where the dogleg bolt handle actually deposits your hand, it actually puts it right here at the trigger, which is nice. I fall right into the semi-pistol grip. The trigger itself, it's actually got a good bit of texture to it, and I thought these little rivets in here were gonna dig into my finger more, which they had before on prior triggers, but they're actually really nice. They actually helped me to keep my finger on here. I didn't feel like I was gonna slip at any point. The actual trigger, when I manipulate it, it's got a good bit of take up, all clean. The brake, also smooth, that was nice. It's a two-stage trigger, so it's smooth, easy take up. You feel that second part where you just pull to break, and it just, you're not expecting it, you're not anticipating it. But this was one of my favorite triggers I have manipulated to date. It was amazing. The last thing I do want to talk about is the safety itself, because where this bolt handle, like I said, deposits your hand, I'm right here at the safety, so I'm ready to flip it on or off at any moment. So as a shooter, this was awesome.
I think you might be missing a major component here. What happened after you pulled the trigger?
You know, the recoil on this wasn't as bad as I was anticipating. That muzzling down and the weight I was talking about earlier, I thought it was going to be a problem, but it actually kind of helped. It helped me to just reset the gun a little bit faster. And as far as 303 goes, it's not a light round, but I feel like the weight really did help with that. This gun, while it's 46 inches, it kind of felt like a 50-incher, just because the recoil was just so easily manageable, in my opinion. But overall, I didn't think it was that bad.
Now, I might be psychic, but I think I know the answer to the final question on this one. However, I have one to kind of fit in there right in between. I want to know your opinion on using, down here in the low country of South Carolina, surrounded by forest and more forest and no line of sight for more than 100 yards, how did you feel about those volley sights?
You know, they're actually really easy to manipulate for me. Like, granted, you have to get a little bit of a thumb under them, but they're easy to use as far as opening up, but I didn't really get a chance to test them out just because we don't have the range space. So I unfortunately can't really give my opinion on that one.
Honestly, they really are a non-factor. The British were ditching them as soon as these rifles were being put into production, like I said earlier, and they got rid of them the minute they had a chance going into World War II. So the volley sights aren't a major factor, although they are there, so hey, get a mention. All right, so let's round this out properly now. We have another gun coming up. We can't really get into huge comparative detail just yet, but just sort of a, you know, yes or no. Would you be comfortable with this rifle in the trenches of World War I?
You know, it's honestly, you can tell it's going to be a yes for this one. However, I'm going to need to hold a few of my comments back about it because I do have one in another configuration, but different caliber to try out and talk about to you guys. So it's kind of a yes for now, but we'll find out which one I prefer later.
All right. Well, on that note, if you can't figure out what the next episode for part two is going to be, I can't help you. Well, I can, but it'll be 2 weeks. Anyway, we'll wrap things out for now. Updates will be after the credits. And again, I want to say a very special thank you for all the help from Jonathan Ferguson over at the Royal Armouries. He is a saint and absolutely patient with all of our questions. Support him however you guys can over there. All right. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you later.
Later, guys.
Alright, audio only update, because honestly I'm down to the wire, plus I got some cool pictures. Anyway, let's see, first on the docket, trip season is over. I don't know if anybody realizes this, but we went to Kentucky, which was like 18 hours round. We went to DC, which was like 17 hours round. We went to Springfield, which is a 32 hours round trip. Yeah, we blew ourselves out on the road, and that's part of why we picked up that big old battle wagon that we've been talking about. But I am calling a trip to a halt until we can get two episodes up, because I am tired of doing these things last minute. It is Monday night as we speak. Anyway, other announcements to make are that our good friend from across the pond, Matthew Moss of Historical Firearms, gave us a visit.
God save the queen.
And our patrons are the best because we are $3 shy of 2K, which is super helpful when I'm trying to rebuild a Chevy to haul all the equipment around to go out of town again to get you guys some more machine guns. Honestly, a lot of the travel has to do with getting you guys machine guns. Let's see, what else? I'm working my way through the Lewis episode. Just be patient, guys. It's taking some extra time to get the animation set up and order some extra parts. And then the only thing else is to say that we have actually been giving Instagram a shot, mostly because I ended up with a phone that can run Instagram. I'm not good with phones. All right, well, that's it, guys. Thank you for all your support. We appreciate you all watching. Okay, I love you. Bye-bye.